probably over, to be honest with you. Okay, we're just finalising the setup on the stage, but I will begin our introduction to panel session 6, personal and community support. So to begin, we have a message from Minister for the NDIS, Bill Shorten.
Hello. In the spirit of reconciliation, I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the country that I'm in today, the Ngunnawal people. I'd like to pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. And I again extend my respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples here today. I'd also like to acknowledge all people with disability here today for your ongoing role that you play in our community and helping shape a better, more inclusive Australian society. I'm really sorry that I can't be there with you in person today, but I want to thank my colleague, the Minister for Social Services, Amanda Rishworth, for inviting me to say a few words so I can still participate, at least in a virtual capacity. Let me say what an honour it is, what a privilege, to be the Minister for the NDIS, to have the opportunity to make some genuine change and improve and empower the lives of hundreds of thousands of our fellow Australians and the people who love them. It is probably the thing which I'm most proud of in my working career. I can certainly think of nothing else that I'm more proud of. You know, now there's about 550,000 NDIS participants. Of course, there's about 4.5 million Australians who identify as living with a disability. So beyond those NDIS participants, that's a huge number of Aussies who might require periodic or additional support to go about their everyday life. I want to make sure that we get it right. The Australian government is enabling anyone with a disability to lead an ordinary life, to lead the life that they want to live, not to be a stranger in their own body, but to have choices. I think this forum and other forums are such an important aspect of this, as they provide an important opportunity to pause and reflect on the disability landscape in Australia, to talk to each other, to compare stories, to see where we're at, and of course, where we want to get to. Because as we know, gee, there's a long way still to go to make sure that people with disability are truly included in Australian society. We in the Albanese government are committed to delivering better outcomes and supports for all of you to improve your lives, to have agency and choice, for you to be seen and heard the way that you all deserve to be. That's why forums like this are so unbelievably useful and important. If you will, I'd just like to talk for a moment about the NDIS. But really, I think the approach is the same whether or not someone is on the NDIS or not, but I'll start with the NDIS. We need to restore trust, not only in the National Disability Insurance Scheme, but in all parts of government, so that people with disability have greater control in their lives and they realise that the government is actually genuinely fair dinkum on their side. Our National Disability Insurance Scheme is something that we should all be proud of in Australia. I know I am. 14 years ago when I started talking about it, it didn't exist. Now it does. But I now know that there are a number of necessary steps that we need to make sure it can live up to the promise it envisaged when we first created it. Rest assured, I and Minister Rishworth, indeed the whole Albanese team, will be taking the steps. We want to make up for the lost time of the last 9 years in achieving the full potential of the NDIS. I get it works really well for a lot of people, but for other people, not so well. We just simply want to ensure no one's left behind. Now, of course, we've got a lot of improvements that need to be made, but we've already made some progress on key issues since being given the privilege of forming a government at the last election in May this year. But we're certainly not done yet with progress. I've just recently announced the independent review of the National Disability Insurance Scheme. I promise it will have people with disability at its core. We will work with people with disability, for people with disability, but alongside people with disability. I want to make sure that our National Disability Safety Net is strong and responsive, that it does what it's meant to do. Disability could be any of us, from the birth of a precious child to the blink of an eye to the onset of ageing. It's so important. That's why I'm confident the review will identify ways we can improve the NDIS to get it back on track. So it's not a variable experience, so you don't have the midnight anxiety of what's going to happen to your plan. I want the scheme to be more effective, more empathetic, and I want it to stand the test of time so it doesn't rely on well-intentioned individuals. Friends, we do not have a minute of a day of a week to waste. I know many people have told your story before. You might be feeling tired. My goodness, they just want to talk to us again. I've been consulted, but nothing happens. Well, friends, this review will be the review of reviews. It's going to take into account all the existing evidence, all the good ideas which got left on the shelf gathering dust. We'll use the existing evidence about the scheme's problems and its potential solutions. It'll be led by people with disability, genuine co-design, genuine engagement, not just consultation, pat on the head. That's how we want to find solutions together. The review will hand down its final report no later than October of next year. But that doesn't mean that we're going to wait until then to fix the scheme. I'll make sure that any interim findings are implemented as soon as possible. We can get on with it now, can't we? Hey, I also want to remind you of our great new recent appointment of a new chair of the National Disability Insurance Agency, Mr. Kurt Fernley, AO. Kurt is the first person with a disability to be the chair of the National Disability Insurance Scheme. His appointment's well overdue. I rate him personally. I know he will help lead the way for greater co-design as we plot a new and better course. Did you know now there are 5 board members with disability, including Kurt, and a majority of the board at least have lived experience? I think it's crucial to have people with disability involved in key decision making. You know the old slogan, nothing about us without us. I believe that people with disability on the scheme and generally need to see they're being represented by their own. This is a journey to a better NDIS, is one that we're all on together. We're also going to have Ms. Rebecca Falkingham leading the NDIA as the CEO. She's an awesome seasoned leader in the public service, ready to lead the agency behind the biggest social reform since Medicare. One of the first things that the Albanese Labor government did was to sit down with the states and the territories, their partners in what we do, to lay out all the challenges that we're seeing on the table. I and Minister Rishworth have been meeting regularly with state and territory disability ministers to put our heads together to problem solve these challenges. For example, a key issue is getting people with disability who are ready to go home, medically fit, to be discharged from hospital. We need to get them into appropriate accommodation, which is better for them with the right supports. I've also been talking to the federal and state health ministers to make sure that we're all on the same page. Because haven't we seen too often where the health system doesn't talk to the disability system? I don't want to waste any precious resources keeping people who shouldn't be in hospital there any longer than they humanly need to be. Also, and very importantly, I've been working to reduce the legacy cases before the AAT. You know, that's the people who've got to take their own government to court to stop an unfair cut. We've reduced the net number of cases by 500 from 4,500 to 4,000. But really positively, since the election, nearly 1,700 of the matters which were banked up have been resolved. I want to make sure we get that list of cases down. It'd be great to halve that list to 2,000 by Christmas. We want to make the dispute process quicker and fairer for participants, not a David and Goliath struggle between a top end of town lawyer and a participant without representation. So I've announced a pilot to develop a better approach to resolving NDIS appeals more quickly and fairly, delivering on Labor's election commitment to have an alternative dispute resolution pathway for the NDIS. The last thing we want to do is be sending people to court. I'm also determined to zero in on those rent seekers who would fleece Australians with permanent significant disability of their NDIS funding. Whether or not it's criminals and fraudsters trying to target the scheme, or dodgy providers overcharging for services, or charging for services they don't deliver them at all. I put the rent seekers on notice, time is up. No longer will we be able to rip off people with disability and the taxpayer. I think some of these early accomplishments that we're making together are just the beginning, but they should be signs of trust and taking them as trusting. That's what we've been able to achieve in just the first 2 or 3 months. I'm so excited by what we can do in the future. I just want to put hope back into the system. I want to say, of course, that the NDIS is just one of a part of a larger system or ecosystem of supports for Australians with disability. It's important for us to keep in mind also that for the NDIS to succeed the way we all want it to, then it just can't simply be the only lifeboat in the ocean for people living with a disability. We need to make sure there's other choices for people with disability. As I mentioned earlier, you might remember, I said there's over 4 million Australians living with disability. That's a huge number of Australians who may not be able or may not be eligible for the NDIS, but they still need some kind of support. We need to make sure the states, territories, and other mainstream services are working together to ensure they have a disability lens, to ensure that support is needed, that no one is left behind or slips through the cracks. Friends, it is true, the NDIS is a key pillar in the way we support Australians with disability, but it's just one element of the overarching national disability strategy. We need to make Australia a more inclusive and accessible place for us all. And this can't just be done by funding participants through the NDIS. It's a combined effort of governments, all levels of governments in Australia, and business in the community, all Australians in fact, to make sure that people with disability are equal. They can access their communities. It's not the disability which stops the access, it's the lack of support. Again, we know there's still a lot to be done, but we are getting on with the job, I promise you. Thanks. I hope to see you soon. Sorry I couldn't be there. Thanks for what you're going to talk about.
Thank you, Minister Shorten. We now have a message from the Tasmanian Minister for Disability Services, Jo Palmer.
Hello everyone, I'm Jo Palmer, Minister for Disability Services, joining you from the island of Lutruwita, Tasmania. It's extremely important to the Tasmanian government that Tasmanians with disability receive the support that they need so we can be a fully accessible island. Accessible Island is Tasmania's action plan for disability, our commitment to ensure Tasmanians with a disability are able to participate in, contribute to, and benefit from local opportunities. We're currently reviewing our Disability Services Act 2011 to ensure it's fit for purpose and meets the needs of Tasmania with disability now and into the future. Personal and community support and the progress we're making in Tasmania as part of our commitment to Australia's Disability Strategy 2021-31 is key to achieving our Accessible Island vision. Access to reasonable and necessary disability supports, including assistive technology that alleviates or reduces the need for formal supports, is critical for people with disability to live their life how they want. In Tasmania, more than 12,000 people with disability have access to those supports now through the NDIS, and more than 7,000 people with disability have access to supports for the first time since the NDIS commenced full scheme in 2019. I also recognise the important role that family, friends and informal carers play in the lives of people with disability, and of course the role that advocacy plays. Our government recognises that all levels of government, the community and individuals, need to work together to ensure people with disability can participate as equal members of our society.
Thank you, Minister Palmer. It's now my pleasure to hand over to the wonderful people on stage, beginning with the facilitator of the session, Dr. Ben Gauntlett. So Dr. Ben Gauntlett is the Disability Discrimination Commissioner at the Australian Human Rights Commission. He serves on many advisory committees. This includes the Health Emergency Response to COVID-19 for People with Disability. And I can tell you, Ben, that there are many questions that have come through Slido that I think would be great for you to answer. He also leads the Australian Human Rights Commission's engagement into the Royal Commission into Violence, Abuse, Neglect and Exploitation of People with Disability. Dr. Gauntlett has a Master of Laws from the New York University and a Doctor of Philosophy in Law from the University of Oxford, where he studied as a Rhodes Scholar. He'll be joined by speakers Anne Kavanagh, who's joining us virtually, Grace Edward behind me on stage, and Kerry Allen Zinner, also on stage. Over to you.
acknowledge and pay my deep respects to the traditional owners of the land where I am presenting to you today, the Ngunnawal people. I pay respects to their elders past, present and emerging, and acknowledge their continuing connection to country. I also acknowledge all other Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander elders and community members who are here today. It would also be remiss of me not to acknowledge people with disability who are here today, and both presently and online. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, thank you for that very kind introduction, Anya. We've heard from Minister Rishworth, Minister Shorten, and Minister Palmer, and I thank them for their kind remarks. I have been asked to discuss the personal and community sport outcome area of Australia's disability strategy and how it should deliver. Yesterday, we went from Cicero to Kool-Aid to bringing sexy back in house design. In some ways, this area may be slightly more benign, but it is undeniably important. However, before doing so, I would like to thank the members of Australia's Disability Strategy Advisory Council who I've worked with over the last year. They are Jane Spring, Natalie Wade, Seriako Stephen, Cindy Liu, Liz Reed, and our other specialist advisor, Kathy Hoff. In the forward to Australia's Disability Strategy, it is stated that the new strategy is an aspirational roadmap pointing the way ahead. It represents our national commitment to enabling every Australian to meet their potential, to achieve, to have a fair go, and to have real choices. The suggested outcome for personal and community support is that people with disability have access to a range of supports to assist them to live independently and engage in their communities. Supports include mainstream services available to anyone. It is noted, it is important for people with disability to be able to live independently and be involved in community activities such as education, work, training, recreation, cultural life, and neighbourhood priorities. The policy priorities are, first, people with disability are able to access supports that meet their needs. Second, the National Disability Insurance Scheme provides eligible people with permanent and significant disability with access to reasonable and necessary disability supports. Third, the role of informal support is acknowledged and supported. And fourth, people with disability are supported to access assistive technology. I wish to make 3 points in relation to this outcome area. Universal design is a human rights issue of concern to all Australians. Universal design does not just apply to the built environment. It applies to the services we offer, the policies we make, how we communicate, and how we include. Universal design prevents segregation and enables people with disability to participate as an equal to others. Second, the success of the National Disability Insurance Scheme and Australia's Disability Strategy are interrelated. If the National Disability Insurance Scheme is the house, the Australian Disability Strategy is the foundations upon which the house is built. If you build a house with bad foundations, it often will fall apart. We need to make sure that the foundations are put in place to enable the National Disability Insurance Scheme to thrive. However, in doing so, we also need to acknowledge that there are other accident compensation schemes that exist in Australia which are dependent on the National Disability Insurance Scheme. Not every person with disability in Australia will be a participant on the National Disability Insurance Scheme. We've heard repeatedly that 4.4 million Australians live with disability. But the definition of disability is not consistent in Australia. And what people often forget is that actually 47.3% of Australians live with an underlying chronic health condition. So when we talk about good disability policy being good for all Australians, it is now, but more importantly, it definitely is in the future. When we talk about stakeholders as they apply to disability policy in Australia, carers, families, friends and colleagues of people with disability are a significant stakeholder. We need to ensure that each and every Australian understands the importance of disability policy to everyone, now and in the future. And finally, access to well-designed assistive technology and equipment can be inclusive, but it can also be deeply exclusionary. When we do not design our equipment and our technology to include all people with disability, and that includes the way we communicate, it can exclude. It can exacerbate disadvantage. When we talk about technology and equipment, we need to acknowledge that disability is an aspect of each and every one of those discussions. It cannot be forgotten that just because something is done by a computer does not mean that it is unreviewable. We need to ensure that we make technology an enabler of people with disability having a good life, not a way to increase segregation and create a gateway to violence, abuse, neglect, and exploitation. So I'm very lucky to have been asked to facilitate a wonderful panel, and what I'm going to do then is just give a brief overview of my fellow panelists, who one of the most intimidating aspects of my role is whenever you introduce someone, they're always far more qualified than what you are, which is deeply challenging. But I'm going to introduce each of the panelists, and then they're going to speak for 5 minutes after I introduce all three. So the first panelist who is online is Professor Anne Kavanagh, who is the head of disability and health in the Melbourne School of Population and Global Health at the University of Melbourne. She is also a director of the Centre of Research Excellence in Disability and Health. Anne is an expert in health inequalities, focusing on disability and gender. Welcome, Anne. Grace Edward is the Youth Coal Disability Collective co-founder and chair, who are also the Partnerships and Community Engagement Coordinator with Refugee Health Network Queensland. Grace, I'm aware you're a playwright, a director, and a creative producer, and that you've used storytelling to understand the world and call for change. Grace has a Bachelor of Arts in Contemporary and Applied Theatre. Thanks for coming, Grace. I look forward to hearing from you. And finally, Kerri-Ann Zinner is a leader and mentor within the West Australian disability sector, where she has promoted disability awareness and supports people's human rights. Kerri serves as a member of the Independent Advisory Council to the National Disability Insurance Scheme, where she has advocated for people living with disability throughout her whole career. Sadly, it's been suggested to me, Kerri, that you're looking to transition to retirement, which is unfortunate for people with disability, but I'm delighted you've been able to spend time with us today, and thanks again for coming. And I might, though, turn to you for your 5 minutes, and then I'll turn to the other speakers on the panel.
Thank you very much. And then I have to just say, I've been threatening retirement for 5 years, and so don't be too concerned. First of all, Ms. Horney, it is a privilege and a pleasure to be here, and I too pay my respects to the custodians of the land on which we meet. I also pay respects to the owners of the land in which I come from, Western Australia, Wadjalunga country, and I say that on behalf of my friends and colleagues who are also here from Western Australia, Wadjalunga country. Before I begin reading, I'd just like to reflect on the day before and this morning. We hear a lot about acronyms, labels, people with disabilities in general, all of the things that we need to hear and say over and over again. What we often forget to think about is who we are beyond that. My message to government, my message to the Department of Social Services is that we are much more than people with a disability. Each one of us here today, by default, is a child of a parent. Most of us are brothers or sisters or cousins or nieces or nephews or friends. So our life is not just shaped by disability. Our life is shaped by humanity. And I think it's an important message to remember when we're shaping communities and support for all people. So I have spent most of my life and career working towards true equality for people living with disabilities through all stages. My resolve and commitment to human rights began without my even understanding. As a small child, navigating my own way through an often cruel and patronising societal experience where adults and children alike were often had really poor preconceived ideas and low expectations for those of us with disabilities. I remember many times stepping up to speak on behalf of friends and other students at our segregated school that was set behind high barbed wire fences and called the Spastic Welfare Association. Children with varying needs who were not listened to, who were not being heard, I became a voice. I learned tricks of the trade in my local community to help you become included. I learned that to give, to get, you have to give. And that is something that I think all people need to understand. If you want to get, you need to give. Having manners and being friendly was always helpful. But there was nothing more powerful than wobbling around the neighbourhood with a pocket full of lollies to entice a kid to come and talk to you for the 2 minutes that it takes for people to realise that you're okay. Mind you, I don't suggest you do that today. You'll probably get arrested. I've been part of the NDIS journey and shaping since before the scheme began. And I've had input into the Australian Disability Strategy as a person with lived experience. At last, most people in our communities have a basic idea of the NDIS. We have promoted NDIS, we have promoted people with disabilities on our TVs, our politicians' campaigns. Most people understand a basic idea of NDIS. The same cannot be said for communities' knowledge of the Australian Disability Strategy. So if we don't understand the foundation, where do we put the house? Sorry, Ben, Princess. Both need to become integral to work together in order to strengthen the NDIS, ensure sustainability, and disallow price gouging and advantage taken of the scheme by businesses who become registered in order to charge a higher fee or charge than if we walked or wheeled into that service like any other citizen. The Australian Disability Strategy's vision is for an inclusive Australian society that ensures people with disability can fulfil their full potential. How can this be achieved when we are looked at as a commodity that can be charged at a higher price than the general community? Outcome 4 of the strategy says people with disability can access support to meet their needs. In my opinion, most people with disability do not want any more than we need, but absolutely rely on quality support to enhance life experiences and community participation. So what are some of the barriers that prevent communities' full engagement? For me, a huge and frustrating barrier that has affected my whole life is community's attitude and understanding of inclusion. When I'm in the and it changes dependent on whether I present alone or with another person. So when I'm in the community with a support worker, it's because I need that support, not because I've suddenly become invisible or incapable. When I'm out with family or friends, it's because we're doing something together, hopefully something fun. And yes, they are my informal supports, and way too often the community views those situations as a means to not fully engage with me. So we need to provide training for the community to understand that everybody has a right to be where they are and still be acknowledged. In closing, we live in one nation. We all have a heartbeat. We all have a story. Let us be strong in our resolve to ensure that the wider community knows the importance of the strategy as the foundation for the future of the NDIS. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kerry. And I note the questions on Slido are coming in, and please keep them coming in because we will seek to answer those questions after we hear from Grace and then Anne. Grace, if I could turn to you then to present. We do have a little bit of time pressure though, so if you could keep it to 5 minutes would be fantastic, but I'm really looking forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, I will try. Badinyo, kare kekine senaga gures. Nana Roma kuta giri kuta iligeling. Hello, my name is Grace, and I greet you all with one heart. My pronouns are she and they. My mother was born to a clan called Abegi and my father Teremo. My sub-tribe is called Kakua, and the tribal group I belong to is called Bari. My people can be found all over East Africa and now the rest of the world, but we originate from a city nicknamed Small London, Yei, in South Sudan. I am a proud woman of African descent with a disability. Sorry, it's really hard to say that sometimes. I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land, the Ngunnawal people, and pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. To me, it is very important to speak my identity and heritage into each space I occupy because these are the intersections I navigate life through, including Australia's perception of me as a refugee and being categorized as a black person, which only allows people to see my skin color and nothing more. Living within these intersections creates many barriers such as equitable access to information, healthcare, and disability support, health literacy, language and communication, education, technology literacy, housing, engagement and lack of inclusivity, safety and dignity, cultural stigma and bias towards people with disability within African communities and the Australian community at large. Discrimination, racism, and tokenism, but most of all, basic human rights. Most times I feel like I have to code switch because most people do not have the culturally responsive practices to hold space for me as I am. They only see me through the lens of a single identity. For example, they only see a refugee, a woman, or my disability. It is clear that people who are part of grassroots community groups have better outcomes when accessing NDIS or other disability support. This is because they are receiving holistic support from their trusted community networks and have people who understand the cultural barriers they may face in navigating systems. Therefore, they have a place to seek culturally responsive support when new barriers arise. Peer lived experience support, where they are understood and are supported by people they trust in a culturally responsive way. This is something I have personally experienced as a member of the Youth Called Disability Collective, a collective that Cindy and I co-founded in 2020 to create a safe space for young people with lived experience of disability from migrant and refugee backgrounds. For people with disability who identify as culled, refugee, asylum seeker, and those on protection visas, it is important to have access to housing that can fit large families. Housing that is accessible and can fit large families. For this government to make a commitment to support people with disability who cannot access the NDIS or other disability supports that are only low cost for citizens or permanent residents. It is imperative that our translation services receive more funding to upskill and train more translators for languages not yet recognized or identified by our government. It is crucial that we see ourselves represented in today's media and television to ensure that information shared to culled communities is in plain English, visual or audio formats as most people learn their languages orally. It is important that support for our communities is holistic and includes the whole family. It is important that the support does not demonize our cultures but works to understand it and work with it. It is important that funding is sustainable and flexible for communities to initiate grassroots initiatives. And lastly, I want to leave you with an Ngui Ubuntu term, with an Ngui Bantu term, Ubuntu. Directly translated, this means humanity. But in the Bantu language, it is a philosophy that means I am because we are. It is a belief in a universal bond of sharing that connects all humanity. Therefore, I am because we are, and I cannot be if we are not. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Grace. That was fantastic, and I particularly liked your reference to intersectional issues, which I think is something that hopefully, as the Australian Disability Strategy moves forward, is something that becomes a really clear and important aspect of how we discuss disability rights now and in the future. I might then go to Professor Anne Kavanagh, who's online, who will kindly present for us. Thanks, Anne.
Thanks a lot. It's hard to follow those two geeks. They were sensational. Ben's introduced me. I'm a professor at Melbourne Uni, and people who do know me probably know that I do a lot of research on disability. But today's presentation's a little bit more personal, though. So, and it's quite different than what I usually present. I'm also someone who has my own physical and mental health related disabilities, but those disabilities are intermittent and wax and wane throughout much of my adult life. This year has been a particularly bad year for me, but most people wouldn't know that most of the time because my own disabilities are mostly invisible. I'm also a parent of a nearly 20-year-old young man who's autistic and has an intellectual disability and is an NDIS participant. And I'd really love to co-present with him, but that really isn't an option. So my reflections are somewhat are about both of us. And I think that's the important thing here. Minister Rushworth talked about how people with disabilities are also carers. Because my son and I and the rest of our family exist in relationships, and the ways in which each of us is supported or not profoundly affects each other. Earlier this year, I spent much of the time fighting the NDIS and cuts to my son's plan, just like many other people, and that had its own very profound impacts on my own health. But perhaps that's another story. I want to touch here perhaps on the way in which some personal community supports have been done right. Yesterday, I note there was a lot of talk about COVID, and I've been very active in that space, and it's been a very terrible time for people with disabilities. But there were also innovations during COVID, and innovations that saw my son access healthcare that he'd not been able to access ever before, access mainstream supports. He hadn't been vaccinated since he was very young. In Victoria, we saw the introduction of disability liaison officers. Disability liaison officers helped me and my son and many other people with disabilities access vaccinations. They found a quiet space where he could be vaccinated, supported by workers who cared for him. And then later, earlier this year, they also helped us out with another medical problem, coordinating with the Austin Hospital to get him access to a team of medical and maxillofacial specialists. They made it their business for him to be able to access healthcare that is his right. And that, to me, is an example of a scheme that has helped him access mainstream health supports. In terms of disability services and supports, I feel like we face a constant battle to resist traditional options. It will be so easy for us to just do the usual stuff, the day programs, the ADEs, for him to perhaps move into a group home. But my son shows us constantly what he wants. He's social, he likes being out and about, and he likes hanging out with folks his own age, going to gigs, playing music. He likes working. We employ a team of workers and allied health professionals who are orientated towards seeing possibilities, who work with him and us. He's got lots of gardening jobs now. He keeps collecting them, mowing and whippersnipping. He works in a local warehouse someone in the local market who he's got to know over many years of going to the market. He spends some time in a share house with his worker and other housemates, just hanging out with those housemates, doing what young people his age do. We're often asked about the qualifications of his workers or why we don't use a registered provider. Planners sometimes look surprised or express concern when we share our ways of doing things. And so as we look to the NDIS review, I think we need to worry about the focus on training and registration without thinking about quality. Will it stifle individualisation and innovation? And in terms of informal support, I want to talk about interdependencies. Somewhat uncertain about the use of the term in informal support, but I'll put that to one side. As my son is now an adult, there are things I should no longer do, but which are sometimes expected of me because he has a disability. And there are times when my own disability is so depleting that I can't support anyone else. And the system isn't really set up for folk like me, where the wheels could fall off or I could be chugging along. Okay. I'm told every time we go to a planning meeting that it's about my son, and I'm not the issue. Maybe that's true, but there's nothing constant about my capacity to provide him with so-called informal support. And I just want to really do put a yell out for when you do have informal support. I myself, I've had tremendous informal supports through my own family and friends and work colleagues. And I do wonder whether we need to unpack this notion a little bit more, because it seems to be about relationships. It's about looking out for each other. What would it mean if a society was orientated towards looking out for each other, looking out for disabled people when the wheels fall off for me? How might my workplace look different? How might the community look different? And as a researcher, it's really interesting for me as someone who's a bit of a data nerd to think about how that data could capture these interconnections and interdependencies of folk like me and my son. I don't think they can. But I think we need to think about it. Otherwise, we'll miss out on answering questions about how we can both be supported to thrive.
Thanks very much for that, Anne. That was most informative, and it's great to hear about yourself and your son, and I'm sure everyone learnt a lot from what you articulated in your presentation. We've got then now, I think, about 13 minutes for questions. Questions can be taken from Slido, but it's also possible to take questions in the audience. I thought I'd throw it open to the audience. Does anyone have a question they'd like to ask? Well, it looks like silence is golden from the audience, so I might then move to Slido and ask a question of the panel members. One of the questions that's been raised is how do we ensure that people with invisible disabilities are properly considered and provided for in Australia? One of the enormous concerns that exists is the presence of COVID now and in the future and the effect that can have on people who are, for example, immunocompromised, and the need for COVID to be properly considered. But I might start with you, Kerry, if it's all right. But how do we ensure that people with invisible disabilities are always considered in the policy frameworks?
It's paramount that we do. There are more people with invisible disabilities than we would ever know because they are invisible. I think a lot of the problem intersects with the health system as well. Many people that have invisible disabilities may intersect with mental health systems or other health systems. And mental health and health services themselves don't marry with NDIS very well at this point at all. And we need to work with government and to bring the two systems together, the three systems together, so that they acknowledge each other and work together in a cohesive way. I think it's also really important that we move away from stereotypical speak and advertising. A physical disability is really easy to advertise. In fact, ta-da, you don't even have to advertise. Many other disabilities are not obvious, and unless a person is really willing to be brave enough to disclose, then they're likely to go without supports and services along the way. We also know that some of those invisible disabilities can be hereditary and can be genetic. So how do we intercept and bring those disabilities to the forefront so that we can work towards supporting the next generation? So I'm not sure that answers. I don't have a magic bullet for the question, but surely promotion, just help, promotion generally in all of the work that NDIS and the strategy does to promote people with disabilities, we need to see invisible disability represented in those pages.
Thank you, Karen. I think whilst you may not have a magic bullet, you've certainly got some really great ideas in terms of the area, so thank you. Grace, I might move to you then on this question on invisible disabilities, if that's all right.
Yeah, I think it's something you said earlier, Kerry, about understanding the foundation before you build a house. Sometimes my disability is not as obvious as most, and people mistake what I have for a lazy eye. So without make the assumption of mistaking my disability for a lazy eye without asking questions and understanding. So I think first thing is just ask the question and understand what kind of support someone with an invisible disability might need and work that into policy in the system.
Thanks, Grace. So I guess from what I took from that, communication is really important.
Yes.
And communicating with the person with disability themselves.
Yes.
And I wonder if I might go to you on this question of invisible disability, if that's okay. Do you have any reflections?
Yeah, it's a tough one because so often it doesn't look like very much is happening. There are some real invisible disabilities. I think mental health issues are one that that you spend a lot of time masking. I've spent a lot of time masking. The other two that I really think are not thought about and affect, I have MS and MS is associated with a lot of fatigue, and for many people with MS also a lot of pain. Pain and fatigue are two other very, very debilitating experiences that are so often dismissed. I don't know how many times people have said to me when I've talked about fatigue, oh, but everyone gets tired. And I don't know then how to say to someone, actually, you have no idea what you are talking about. And I think actually, unfortunately, people are going to find that out because a lot of folk are getting long COVID now. So they do know what brain fog, fatigue feels like. But actually, I think we really need to actually to put that on the table. And I think... So invisible disability, it's hard to talk about. It's very hard to talk about. It's not so obvious. It's easy to try and mask and pretend you're doing okay when you're not. And I think it's about time that I think the main point I wanted to make today really was about the relationships that the NDIS is focused on individuals out of context of relationships, and that those relationships are important. And so if one of your so-called primary supports experiences a lot of fatigue, that actually does really matter, and that needs to be taken into account. And in workplaces, I want to say one thing actually. When I was first diagnosed with MS, my fatigue was one of my most debilitating symptoms. I was a professor. And I was able to negotiate in my workplace to sleep in my office. I had an office to sleep in. I had a place, people respected me. I was able to negotiate that workplace adjustment. And I often wonder and reflect, if I had been somewhat younger, a young research assistant coming into the university system, whether I would have got the same respect and the same compassion and the same workplace adjustment.
Yeah, thank you, Anne. That's very informative, and we do need to, one of the comments in Slido was to increase the understanding of disability literacy relative to a knowledge of health conditions in Australia to get that understanding and appreciation of how disability intersects with different circumstances. We do have a question from the audience, I see, though. Dwayne Cranfield from NIDA, I noticed your hand was in the air. Dwayne?
Thanks, Ben. Yeah, Dwayne Cranville from NIDA. I just want to thank Anne talking about invisible disabilities. I have an acquired brain injury, and it's an issue for me every day in everything that I do, and it has been since 1999 when I acquired it on a really exciting day. And I just want to say that what people don't seem to understand about some of these invisible disabilities, especially the ones that have cognitive impairment, is that your level of capacity can vary very, very quickly. That one moment I can be functioning incredibly well and on top of my game, and the next moment I'm functioning at lower mammal. And that happens on a regular basis. And it could be anything as simple as not enough caffeine, too much caffeine, a glass of wine the night before, or like last night, I drove to Sydney at 10 o'clock to pick up my nephew from Sweden, didn't get back until 2:15 this morning. So today I'm actually struggling to be present in the room. But I think the other issue is I work for a DPO, a National Disability Organisation, that is based around the rights of people with disability. And there are days when I have to remind my board that I have a disability, because I don't look like I have a disability. I just look like somebody else. And so there are days when I've actually got to remind them, my capacity isn't here today. I can't get that to you because I just don't have the capacity to do it. And so even in the disability space, we have to remind each other that these things impact on every aspect of our lives. And like I said, I just want to thank you, Anne, for raising it, because I think it's a thing that I struggle with on a daily basis and have done now since 1999. And yeah, thank you for raising it. And I think it's an issue that the NDIS has to look at as well around capacity, because when we're engaged in organising people's support plans, capacity can vary. You can come in one day and do your planning, and you can be on top of it, and that will determine what the plan is you get. And then 2 weeks later, and this is with psychosocial, this is with ABI, this is all with cognitive disabilities, where capacity varies, it can be very, very different. So we have to get planners to understand that capacity varies, and that people's needs because of that vary as well. So yeah, we have to plan for worst case scenario in these situations. Thank you.
Thank you, Duane, for those comments and also for your continued advocacy in the sector. It's deeply valued. I'd just see if there was anyone else who had a question. If not, we are getting close to time. I do acknowledge there's been a number of comments in Slido relating to online accessibility and the need for compliance with WCAG and to have technology that is accessible for all communication needs. There's also been some really relevant comments and questions which people wanted in relation to the COVID-19 response, and to make sure that we're all aware that COVID-19 remains a particularly important issue now and in the future for people with disability and medical conditions. And then there's been finally some comments in relation to the National Disability Insurance Scheme and people who are not on the National Disability Insurance Scheme, to ensure that each and every Australian is treated with dignity and respect, and treated in a way where they have access to appropriate services now and in the future. But that is about time. I would like to thank my fellow panellists, Grace, Kerry and Anne, for your erudite contributions. And I might hand then back to Anya.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And as usual, I will say another huge thank you to Ben and Grace and Kerry. That was incredible. I learned a lot, as always. A huge round of applause again. So we will now take a 20-minute break and return back at 10:40 Australian Eastern Daylight Time. And for people in the room, there is morning tea next door. So everyone back online, I'll see you back at 10:40. Thank you.
Well done. Looked me in the eye and truly seen what was there. Not who you are, but who am I? How many times have you judged me in your mind?